So Mi'arat Se'if Dalad now, where the Rebbe is going to explain what is so special about the fourth plague, Oroiv, which will also obviously answer all the questions that we have learned till now. Abiyur Bekol Ze'u, the explanation on all above is as follows. Bechol Mako Mako, Bein oison she lifnei makos oroiv, ubein oison she lachareo, regarding every plague, whether it was before that fourth plague oroiv or those plagues which are listed after that plague, arei puronuso v'toichon oinsho muvon v'nikar. So it's very clear what is the punishment of that plague, what is the quality of that. Punishment, what is the plague exactly going to do and how it will occur. Im mitoich divrei ha'asroi shenitno leparoi lifnei avoa samako, you can find out about it, what the plague is, in the warning which is given to Paroi before the plague arrives. Oi, or be'oisan ha'mako sheloi kodmo lo'en ha'asroi, in those plagues which there is no warning prior to him, you can also understand what the plague is mitoch divrei HaKadosh Baruch Hu leMoshe, the way Hashem communicates with Moshe regarding the Mako beishetzivou la'ases ha'peula lehovies ha'mako, and he commands them to do that which will bring about the plague. V'hainu sheyoidim ma'i ha'koe, we know what is the plague exactly going to be. Koidem sheloimdim achar koch, before you learn, only afterwards, on what happened. In other words, you don't only learn and find out about the mako, what it entailed after it happened, but even prior to it. For example, if you look at Makas Dever, so the pasuk says in chapter 9, verse 3, so there is a warning. It says, Ine yad Hashem oyo b'miknoch asher basode, that the end of Hashem is going to be in the livestock that is in your field. Basusim, bachamoirim, bagmalim, babokor, ubatsoin. It mentions specifics. Who is going to be hurt by that mako? So it mentions the horses, the donkeys, the camels, the cattle, and on the flock, and every dever kove meoid, a very severe epidemic. So it's clearly written who is going to get it. Who is going to get hurt by it? Same thing when it comes later in the warning, before, for example, the plague of Borod, Afeil. So you go to chapter 9, verse 18. So it says, In an imam tirkohes mochor borot kovid meoid. At this time tomorrow I shall rain a very heavy hail, such a hail that Egypt never saw. And it mentions who is going to be attacked, and anyone who is going to remain outside, they're going to die by that hail. So it's clearly who is going to be suffering from the borod, people, animals. And similarly, is with all other makas, the way it's written in the Torah. And here, when it comes to oroiv, we don't find any of this. Masheinke b'makas oroiv, shebasro also in the warning of oroiv, the only thing which it says, Ineni mashliach becho v'goymer, eso oroiv, I'm inciting the oroiv against you, umolu bote mitzrayim eso oroiv, the houses of Mitzrayim is going to be filled with the oroiv, v'gama adom asherim olo, the earth which is upon them, but it is mibli loidienu mau inyono shel makas oroiv. What is it? What does it entail? It's written in a very unspecific language or any details. A mixture, oroiv, means a mixed. Irbuvio shelma. Who is going to be mixed? The pasuk doesn't say. Umau porunoso. What is the punishment? What is that? How it's going to attack? What is that mix going to do to you? Is also not mentioned specifically in the pasuk. So now that we have this issue, we're trying to understand why is Oroiv not containing any details. Ze machriach loimar, she meteivas mashliach becho, mudgeshes mehuso shel makozu uporonoso. So that's what gave Rashi to understand that in these words, mashliach bechoyeso oroiv, that I'm going to incite the oroiv against you, that few words, or this even two words, mashliach bechoyes, is going to present what exactly the oroiv is and what is the details and the specifics of this mako. This is all going to be in those words, mashliach becho, incite against you. How? The Rebbe continues, mikivon shekolo hemshech de la'alon, muvon rak, shezeu inyan, shelirbuvye, in the continuation of the psukim, you only learned that there was a mix. And the mix was, boifen shetagia bechol mokoy, that it's going to arrive in every place of you in Egypt. Becho, as the Pasuk says, umolu botem Mitzrayim, the houses of Mitzrayim is going to be filled. Also mentions Vesa'adomo, the earth will is going to be filled with that mix. And it's all following the two words, mashliach becho. Lochein pirash Rashi, that what gives Rashi to explain that mashliach becho means what? Megare becho. I'm going to incite against you those animals. Shemitzad o echrech, amuva le'il seif aleph, lefarish mashliach, megare, based on what we said before, that what is mashliach mean? As Rashi explained, it means inciting against you. Yuvon gam mi uma uva orev. That word and the meaning of inciting tells us already who is that mixed and what is his purpose. Who is it? It is the one, misheshayich boy inyan agirui. The one that it's possible to apply to him that concept of inciting. V'hainu abalechayim. So that applies to animals. So now we know that when it says mashliach becho, inciting against you, so who can be incited? That is animals. So we know that it talks about animals. Ukeshemegarim esabal chai. Once you incite an animal, arimuvim bepashtus, shenoishchim umashchisim vechulu. So this tells us what would they do. So we all know when an animal gets incited, you instigate him. So he's biting and he's destroying. So by the words mashliach, which means inciting, which means the one who gets incited and destroys with that incitement, ari borur mahu oroiv umahu oinesh. So this explains us what is oroiv, what does it entail, and what is the punishment. Akodesh Baruch Hu, which means in simple words, Akodesh Baruch Hu yegare balechaim harbe beiv. Buvia, the Rebbe is going to incite many animals who are going to arrive be it Buvia in a great mix of different types of animals. And what are they going to do? What you do when you are incited? What does an animal do when he's incited? Amitzrim, that they're going to bite and are going to destroy to damage the Egyptians with that. And following that incitement, this is clearly what the word mashliach becho leads us to understand. Vehine, so the Rebbe continues now. Vehine ze shatero mefaretes. The Torah specifies rak ze shebo oroi bilbuvim, that the oroif came in a mix, mikola protim, shebemako, that came in a way of oroif, which oroif means mix. So from all the details of the mako, whatever they did, the biting, the causing injuries, so the Torah only mentions that word oroif, mashliach bechos oroif, ve'acheloi pirshoi so ikel licheure, shebo chayois vechulu, and it doesn't even specify that which is obviously the most needed for telling us about the Orev is the fact that it was wild beasts, wild animals. And we only learn from the word mashliach becho that it does actually mean animals because you incite only animals. So based on that, the Torah, after all, uses only the word Orev, מכריח לומר שעל ידי זה יסבורר דובר שלא יוהינו יוידי מויסי בלבוכה. This makes us to understand that in the word Oroiv we're going to learn something which without that word we wouldn't understand about the plague of Oroiv. Something very special about the Oroiv which only the word Oroiv tells it to us. What is it? Vehu. And this is as follows. Iker achidush ve'anes b'nei ze shebo chayois. Hoyo shebo arbe mine chayel b'erbuvia. The Torah wants to tell us that what is the main idea about the plague of Oroiv is the fact that those animals which are animals and are wild animals and they bite, but the fact is that they are going to come be in buvia, they're coming in a mix, Oroiv. Aval shara protim shoyo b'makozu loy hoyo b'mishum chidush v'neis miyuchet. The other specifics, what happened was about a part of the mako that wasn't any novelty, it wasn't any chidush. The only chidush and the main thing that we have to relate to Oroiv, we are limiting the occurrence of the Oroiv to the fact that what happened over here, the unusual thing what happened is that so many different animals came mixed together, grouping together in their mix to attack Mitzrayim. If that's the chidush, ואם כן, מוכרח לומר שרק חיוס היו בעירוב, ולא בעימוס. But this, the fact that the Torah uses this as the chidush of Oroiv, so that forces us to say that who was involved in that plague of Oroiv? Only non-domesticated animals, but not domesticated ones. How? Because the im gam behemois bo v'ishchisu kemoi v'chulu kemoi achayois, because if domesticated animals also joined, ari dovo ze uchidush godl v'nes b'makozu. This is a tremendous chidush. It's a tzof and a miracle that domesticated animals joined together with the non-domesticated animals to attack Egyptians. But to bakosu betevas oroiv, in the wood oroiv, the way it's specified in the posik, muchach shekol ikeranes oyo rako oroiv, irvu vachayus. But in the posik itself, you clearly see that the chidush is only that there was an oroiv. The Torah doesn't look for more occurrences, which more unusual ideas which took place with the oroiv. The Torah only tells you that what was the Oroiv? It was something very unusual happened, that it was a multitude of animals coming mixed together. Usually they are each one in their own location, with their own group, and here they all group together to attack Mitzrayim. That's the only chidush, nothing else. And therefore, me excluding domesticated animals from being involved in the attack of Mitzrayim. We're not looking for more than the chidush, what the Torah itself tells us, which is the fact that they were mixed. So this is what the real miracle of the Oroiv. But in that case, Amnon lefi ze yikshe. Im oyu b'mako zu rak chayos ha-mashchisos, matzoyder begirui miyuchat. If me really only talking about animals, non-domesticated animals, which by nature they are biting and causing injuries to people, so what is it? Why do they need to be specifically incited? Mashliach bechodit Torah says, I'm going to incite against you. Be'im gobo gam be'emois, muvun she'esoich legaroison. If we would have joined domesticated animals, and they would also be a part of the Oroiv, so that if that would have been the miracle of the Oroiv that they joined to, so domesticated animals, for them to bite, they really need to be incited to do it, because it's not their nature to bite. for non-domesticated animal, this is their nature. They are the ones who always do it. So in that case, why does the Torah say mashliach b'cho? You know, the Rebbe brings in Ora 26 the fact that that an animal which is a non-domesticated animal, a chaya, does not need incitement. We actually learn also from the Chumash itself with the story of Yosef. Let's see it inside. Reikvanemar, Sheoma Yaakov ben Egal Yosef. Yaakov says regarding Yosef, Chayo ro acholoso, that he was consumed by an evil animal. Bevadai lechoshav Yaakov shegiro Hakadosh Baruch Hu Chayo ro be Yosef. Yaakov never thought that the Rebishter incited an animal against Yosef. Especially that he knew who Yosef was, why would Hashem incite an animal against him? The fact that he was attacked by an animal is something natural, that a non-domesticated animal is a person, it will attack him, it doesn't have to be incited by anyone. So from here, we see clearly that in Chumash already, we find this concept that non-domesticated animals have a tendency to attack without being incited to do it. So why does the Torah say by Orev Mashliach Becho, if we're only talking about Chayes, non-domesticated animals? That's why Rashi comes and adds Loshon Shisui. In addition to what Rashi says, that Mashliach means Megare, incite against you, Rashi adds Loshon Shisui, it's an expression of incitement. What does Rashi mean? As we asked before, why does Rashi have to tell it to us, and why is this word adding more than the word Girui? That was from the questions earlier. But now we understand there's a special insight here that Rashi wants to tell us. What does Rashi tell us? Ki af shenekudas ha-peirush b'teivas mashliach imegare. Yes, the simple understanding of mashliach means I will incite them against you. That's what mashliach means. Mikol mokom yeshanon darges begirui. There is multi-levels when it comes to inciting an animal. Yes, girui stam. There is so-called a simple incitement. She'enoi choser b'chayes, that usually an animal does not need it to decide to attack. They have it naturally. They don't have to be incited to do it. But yes, girui chozok. There is a stronger level of incitement. Anikro shisui. She'megarin esachayus. That we are inciting the animals, sheyaziku betoikev godl yoisel miderech harogil, that they should attack the person with much more force, more than usual. So it's not just girui, which is a simple type of incitement that they have by nature when they see a victim, but rather it is shisui, which is the additional level, a further type of incitement, which is called shisui. Vekan shamedubaru b'chayos. Since, as we explained earlier, oroiv means a mixture of non-domesticated animals, which are already by nature carrying the desire to attack. They don't have to be incited to do it. Muchach loimar. Therefore, we have to say that here the incitement was they shouldn't just be the typical or the classic type of incitement, but rather they should be really agitated in order to attack the victim, which in this case it's the Mitzrim, the Egyptians. This is not considered a main a nuance or a big miracle that they're acting against their nature. They are anyway in a tendency of destruction. So here the miracle is not the fact that they decided to destroy. That's what they're doing. They were extra agitated, but this is not something unusual for them. And therefore, being that it's not completely unusual, that's not considered a miracle. The miracle of the Oroiv Mial, limiting the miracle clearly to the fact that there was the mix which came together. And that's why Rashi explains us, Mesh Begare, and Rashi adds the words, Lashon Shisui, the additional type of incitement, which is an extra agitating them in a very, more than usual. And this explains us also why between the word Megare and Lashon Shisui, between the two levels of incitement, Rashi brings the Pasik in Azinu, Veshein Be'emris HaShalach Bo, which is Azinu, and it does not bring the Pasik in Bechukosai, which the Rebbe asked earlier. What is the answer? Says, Velochein, maybe Rashi Raya be a Pasik Veshein Be'emris HaShalach Bo, Veloi me a Pasik Shevepashe Bechukosai, even there. In Parshat Bechukosai, it is also written, Veishlachti bochem eschais, I'm going to incite the animals against you. So why does he bring that later pasuk? Ki mitchilo meforesh Rashi, nekudas apirush betevas mashliach. First Rashi comes to tell us, what is the word mashliach mean? Shehi megare. It means inciting against them. That's the word mashliach. Valze mei viraye mi pasuk. He brings a proof from a pasuk which actually speaks about domesticated animals, which the whole idea of the original incitement really belongs when it comes to domesticated animals. Because naturally they don't damage, they don't bite, so they have to really be incited to do it. So therefore, Rashi brings us that Girui means incitement. Incitement is something which we find in the Pasuk of Azinu, because there we talk in the context of somebody which is like a domesticated animal, which there, from the get-go, he has to be incited to go and bite a person. After Rashi explaining us in general terms, Moisiv Rashi lefarish, that Rashi comes on that, she believed in the Dan, that in our context, in the story of Oroiv, it wasn't just the classic, the original incitement, but rather a girui oyo boifun sheshisui. Why? Ki girui boifun rogil ein tzoyrech bechayos. The typical incitement is not necessary by non domesticated animals, and that's why Rashi has to come and tell us what happened here specifically in regard to the Oroiv. So clearly, Rashi comes with an order. Rashi comes first of all explaining us what is the word mashliach mean. Mashliach means incitement. Then explaining us, in order to understand that incitement means girui, mashliach, he brings the pasuk v'shem behemos hashalach bom, is because the main idea of incitement belongs to behemos, to non-domesticated animals. They need to be incited from the get-go. Then after explaining us generally, Rashi comes and adds that when it came to Oroiv, there were these types of animals, non-domesticated animals, which do not need usually to be agitated to do something like that. So therefore, it was Lashon Shisui, it was an extra incitement to get them really upset and wanting to attack the Mitzrim even more. In there, there is a longer order, but let's go through it. The order over here in Ora 27, the Rebbe goes more into the specifics of the pasuk in Bechukosai and the pasuk in Azinu. Ba'akosli ve'ishlachti bochem eschayas asode, pirish Rashi ve'ishlachti loshen girui. In Bechukosai, Rashi also says, what is ve'ishlachti? I'm going to incite the animal. This is obviously a part of the toichocha, of the admonishment. In Bechukosai, so it says, "Vishlachti bochem." I will send the wild animals, So Rashi says, "Vishlachti loshen giru" is an expression of inciting. Beloy loshen shisui. And Dira doesn't say that vishlachti means shisui, which, as we already learned, is the extra level of incitement. Why? Kishom nichlolim bechayos asode chayos ubehemos. Dirim bechukoisai, when it says the word chayos asode, it includes non-domesticated animals, and plus domesticated animals also, which are usually not biting, they are also included in the word chayos asode. Kamefuresh berashi, Rashi says in Parsha Shmini, shabehemo bichlal chayo. When it says the word chayo, it includes also domesticated animals. Ubimele, since indeed the Pasuk talks about all types of animals, kavona Rashi loima rak nekuda sadover. So Dirim Bechukoisai, Rashi only wants to tell us that Ishlachti is an expression of inciting. That's it. Umuvin, she'oifen agirui b'chayo, shoyne migirui lebeimo. And everyone understands that by an animal, which is a domesticated animal, you're going to need a much more of incitement than a non-domesticated animal. But it means both. And therefore, since it means both, so it's enough for Rashi to write the word Loshen Girui. He doesn't have to write Shisui, which is the extra, more intense level of incitement. But here in Parshas Ishmo in Voero, we're talking about only Chayos. And Chayos are usually standing in all time, they are incited to attack. So here the expression is not just inciting, which they have anyway, but rather it's the additional level of incitement, which is called shisui. Ubelavocha, the Rebbe continues. Either way, muchrach loimar shebechayes asod eshom nichlolim gam be'emos. The fact that in Parshas Bechukoisai it talks about also behemoths, which are domesticated animals, is not only because Rashi tells us in Shmini that behemo is included in Chayo, but rather it is also proven from the very fact that Rashi writes there. What does Rashi say there? Rashi, Mashikosav Rashi Acharkoch. Rashi says, it says in the Pasik, Veshiklo Eschem, that they will brave you. And Rashi says, Dir in Parshas Bechukoisai, Ein li elo chayo meshakeles. On the basis, we know that only a beast, a non-domesticated animal, bereaves a person. Shedarko bekach, this is his way, this is the nature. But behemo, she'ein darko bekach, minay. How do we know that a domesticated animal, how do we know that they too will attack you? Says Rashi, Talmud Loima v'shem be'emo is ha-shalach bom. He brings the pasuk in Parshas Ha'azinu, and I will send the tutor for domestic animal against you, and this proves that they would also attack. V'dechura, ma ra'ye v'pshuta shel mikro, she'gam kan yegare be'emo is, how do we know that here in Parshas Bechukoisai, really the pasuk means that I'm going to incite domesticated animals against you, and it means also domesticated animals, is mizeh shebekosuv acher ubeinyan acher mevuerkein. Just because in Parshas Ha'azinu we have such a pasuk, how does it prove that here in Bechukoisai, how does Rashi learn in Bechukoisai that it's not only chayo, it's not only beast, but also behema, domesticated animals? Pashut chein loyim ashinimad b'gzeiro shove. We cannot answer that it's learned with gzeiro shove, because here it says, Beishlachti, and it says in Azinu Ashalach, like the Sifrei Chachamim says, Shari ain't the derech pshute shel mikro to derive our own gzeiros shavos. The comparison between one pasuk and another, where does Rashi take it? So therefore, muchrach loimar shekavonas Rashi he shal derech pshat. According to pshat, whenever you have the word chayas asode, beasts means everything, non-domesticated plus domesticated animals. That's what Rashi accepts, bepashtus, simply without a proof. If that's what it means, so Rashi is bothered Weil sie makshe, der Rashi wonders on the Pasik. Miacha shekan akavone shegam be'eimo meshakelet, tishakano. That here in this Pasik it says, that those beasts that I'm going to incite against you will actually berave you, even those domesticated animals. So Rashi was wondering, Eifo motzinu she'efshel liyos metzius kezushel emailo minateva. Wouldn't we find something so unnatural that a domesticated animal should kill a person? We find later on, in Parsha Sa'azinu, that if God decrees, it can happen that even a domesticated animal will attack you in a way that it will berate you, it will actually kill you. And that's what Rashi takes in Parsha Bechukosai, the comparison to the Pasuk in Azinu. בהמשך לזה, והדלך הנעל, דד בית רשי דיר קונטיניות, ממשך אחר כך, כבר היו שונים בארץ ישראל, רשי ברינגס דיר, that there was years, that in ארץ ישראל, in ארץ ישראל, that חמור נוישך, that a donkey bites, ומיימיס and kills, אורויד נוישך ומיימיס, meaning there were years in which the theme donkey was just as deadly as the wild one, as the aroid. So we see clearly that there was something that already happened. What does Rashi mean by that? Why does Rashi have to add a proof that something happened practically? Why is it not enough to rely on the pasuk in Parshas Haazinu? Ki afilu lehacha shenimtza kosuv, because even after you have a pasuk in Haazinu, she'efshal liyoy shebe'emoyz teshekanlo, that domestic animals can also kill, but nevertheless, since it's a novelty to say such a thing, so therefore you can assume that ulai zeu rag b'mokem shemefurashkein. So maybe it's only specified and it can only happen when the pasuk tells you, like in Parsha Sa'azinu, there is where we have such a concept. Azem moisiv Rashi, comes Rashi and says, ein ze chidush gadol kol kach. It is a chidush, but not such a great chidush. It's not such a great novelty to that we should say that it never happens unless it's mentioned specifically in the pasuk. Sharei kvar oyu shonim, there were already years in Israel that it happened, and therefore we understand that something like this happened. So basically, this insight into a Rashi, it's actually about the insight in Rashi in Bechukosai, is further just explaining us what we have learned over here, that animals who came to destroy and to participate in the attack, in the plague of Oroiv, were non-domesticated animals. I'm sorry, was only chayois, was only non-domesticated animals, and they needed that extra incitement is because they were expected to do a bigger attack, more than usual, which happens by animals in nature. But clearly, it did not include behemoths, it did not include domesticated animals, only regular non-domesticated animals, and we're not looking to add new insights into Oroiv, rather to keep to the special miracle, which is the fact that they all came as a mixed group. Continuing now, Seifei. Al Pianal, based on the above, that this is what Oriv represents. Shemash Rashi, Yuvanet also understood. Shemash Rashi Mamshi Beperushateva is as Oriv. So Rashi explains what Oriv entails. Kol Mine Chayois Rois, all types of Chayois, of bad animals. Venechoshim Vakrabim. Snakes and scorpions beibuvia coming mixed, v'hoyu mashchisim bohem, and they were causing destruction in the Egyptians. So we asked before, why does he mention specifically nechoshim v'akrabim, and why does he just say in general chayu yisrois? So the Rebbe says here in these words, what Rashi tells us, ein ha'ikorei lefareit mi oyo be'orev. Rashi doesn't come to tell us which animals participate in the orev. From the words Mashliach Becho, you already know that we're talking about the types of animals which attack, and this is Chayo Yisro, is any non-domesticated animal, any beast. Elo, Sheikoroi Boiloimar. So when Rashi comes and tells us Kol Minei Chayo Yisro is not to tell us who came, because this we know already. Those unit who are usually inside it, and they have to get extra inside it. What is it telling us? Shekavonas HaKosu B'teva So'oroiv Ishebor B'ribuvye. Again, the chidush is that they came mixed. V'chizeu aneis v'achidush hayichidi she'oyo b'makozu. And this is the extra miracle and the only novelty in this mako. Noisaf al etzem ha-mako is the fact that they came mixed, all types of animals joining in a mixture together. This is the only miracle. Obviously, there was the plague itself that they attacked. But the miracle and the novelty of the plague is the wood oroiv, coming mixed together. Since Rashi wants to tell us, he has to write us that they came mixed, Moisif Gam, he tells us, Kol minechayois rois, all types of bad animals, venechoshim, veakrabim, plus snakes and scorpions, ki bezem efarish esayir buvye sheoysa bemakozu, by writing that there was all types of animals plus snakes, it only adds further insight and explanation what happened in this plague, that they all came mixed. Velochein, mati gam tevas es. It says, Rashi puts in the eder the word eso oroiv, the oroiv. What is the oroiv? Asheb ze moisif echrech loimar. This only further adds to the idea that we said till now, she iker achidush oyo shebor berbuvia. That the main chidush about, the main insight into the oroiv is the fact that animals can mix together. And this is the main thing, nothing else. Ki be'im ein ze iker achidush, if that would not be the main chidush, v'urak prat echot mikol ha-mako, it would just be like any other detail. So one detail would be, if you would say as follows, that the mako was really that animals came to attack. That was the chidush. And there was another detail that they came mixed. Then, if that wouldn't have been the chidush, that they really, that they came mixed together, eichi tochin loimar, how does the pasuk say, Hineni Mashliach Bechoa, misiding against you, es o oroiv. The word es, de oroiv, muvnoi, shezeu kol mashe megareboi. That this is all what I am going to incite is the mixture. But umizeh shekosuv, hineni Mashliach Bechoa, vegoimer, es o oroiv, de oroiv. In other words, you're inciting the animals, not the mixture. The fact that the pasuk does say Esa Oroiv, the incitement is the mixed group of animal, Muchach Shezeu Achidul Veneisa Miyuchet Shebamako. That's the main chidush, that there was a Oroiv. This is the big thing. And that which happens now and usually, that all different animals are joining together to attack, that miraculous occurrence is what I am inciting against you. In addition to what we said before, that this is what the word oroiv is, and veishlachti actually means. So in addition, Rashi uses the proof, the fact that the pasuk says, es oroiv, that which is oroiv, meaning that occurrence of an oroiv, the unusual idea that you see a mix of animals coming together, which is the main chidush, the main insight and the main nuance of them of that plague. So that's what Rashi takes further as a proof. The main chidush of here is the fact that they came as a mixed multitude of animals. And he says in order 28, Rashi adds the word rois to the animals, because the madgish be yoisel. She'ein achidush kan v'anes boze she'ishchisu. Ki im beze she'bor b'ribuvye. This further emphasizes that the nuance is not that they destroyed, because they were obviously destroying. They are bad animals, so they were destroyed. But the chiddush is they came in a mix, and this is what happened, a special miracle occurring in Egypt, different animals from different places coming all mixed together at the same time to attack the Mitzrim. This is the miracle of Oroiv. Based on that continuous evolve, al pi anal, based on what we have learned till now, Yumtak, it's also going to be further gishmak to understand. Lomo in Rashi mefarish dubim aroyos venamerim. Why doesn't Rashi specify, like the Medrash brings in his opinion, that there were bears, lions, and leopards? Because, says the Rebbe, ein klalo ichoche bepshute shel mikro, eize chayo isroys nimtzu bezmanayi begvulei Mitzrayim v'siveseo. In the simple reading of the pasuk, we don't have any proof to say what specific bad animals existed at that time in the borders of Mitzrayim. There's nothing in the Torah which forces us to say that who were the animals participating in that plague of Oroiv was specifically those bears, lions, and leopards. If Rashi would have specified those three, Oyo Mashma, it would have indicated, that if assuming that we don't find that these animals existed in the surroundings of Egypt, it will mean to say that they viyon HaKadosh Baruch Hu mimokim rochot mimitzrayim, that they came specifically from a further place, and God made them come specifically from far into Mitzrayim to attack. So then that will become an additional miracle into the plague of Oroiv. And again, like we said before, we are not looking to expand the miracle. We are looking to understand what the Pasuk tells us what the miracle was. And according to the Pasuk, the only miracle is the very fact that there was Oroiv, it was a mixture of different animals. So if someone would prove from somewhere that these three animals were not in Mitzrayim, so then you will add new insights into the miracle which we're not looking for. That's why Rashi says simply, there were chayos rois. Which chayos rois? Would non-domesticated animals joined? Hainu, a chayos rois, shehoyum metzuyos os, besvivos gvul Mitzrayim. Whatever beasts were that time surrounding Mitzrayim, wherever they were in the borders of Mitzrayim, mibli lefaret eiz the chayos oyu, they were the ones. And Rashi is not going to add names or titles or specify animals, because according to Rashi, the old miracle of Oriv is the Iruv, the mix. So wherever animal was there, they were all included in that makal. See if Zion, mitamanal yuvan gamke, no echer Rashi lefarish, oyu shom gam lechoshim vakrabi. That would also explain us why Rashi adds snakes and scorpions. As we asked before, this is an addition from Rashi, which we don't find in that medrash, in the two opinions in the medrash. So the Rebbe says a very interesting chiddush where Rashi took it. It's actually in the words of the pasuk. How? The pasuk zeh, when it comes to the pasuk about the plague of Oroiv, Messiah, the pasuk says, Vegam ahadomo asher eimoleo, that the Oroiv is going to come in, bechor ba'avodecho, in your people, in your slaves, ube be'amcho be'botecho, in your houses. And then it says, umolu botei mitraim es oroiv, the houses of Egypt shall be filled with the Oroiv, vegam ahadomo, and even the ground asher eimoleo upon which they are. What is that Eimoleo? Which ground am I referring to? It's very interesting. Let's see the insight. Im oyokosu v'molu oroiv es botei Mitzrayim v'gam o adom asher Eimoleo. If the pasuk would have read that the Oroiv is going to fill the houses of Egypt and the earth which there upon that, o oroiv u ha'iker b'kosuv, then the word Oroiv is the main concept in the pasuk, and that would mean that Umolu bate mitzrayim esa umolu o oroiv es bate mitzrayim. The oroiv fills up the houses. Vegamo adomo asherim leo, and the earth which the houses are upon them. Let's see it inside. Oyo mokim imo yokosu v'mole yorev is bote mitzrayim v'gama adom asherim oleo, that the orev is going to fill them up, or orev hu ha'ika b'kosuv, oyo mokim loimar kihei musav alo iker, which is a orev, that who is going to fill up the houses, and who is filling up the earth, it is the orev, those wild beasts. Be'af, he says in orev, orev loshin yochid. So here too, we find already in other places that it can mean the oroiv, the multitude of animals. But the main thing would be that the oroiv, those animals are the ones filling up the houses and the earth. But the pasuk is not written in that manner, umolu or oroiv. Rather, aval mikibun shekosu, it says in the pasuk, umolu bote mitzrayim es ohoroiv, that the houses of Egypt shall be filled with the mixture of those wild beasts. And therefore, bote mitzrayim o iker, is talking about what happens to the houses, that they are going to be filled. Areze ki'ilu kosuv, it's as if the pasuk writes, umolu bote mitzrayim eso oroiv, the houses of Mitzrayim are going to be filled with the oroiv, vegamo adomo, which adomo, the earth, asher abotim o yamitzrim oleo, molo eso oroiv. The earth, where the houses, or the Egyptians are, dwelling on that earth, that was filled with that orif. That's what the pasuk would have perhaps mean to say. Ve'oid ve'iker, be'kol parsha zu orif uloshin yochid. In the entire parsha, the orif is written in the singular, va'yovoi, v'sor, va'yosar. Ve'im kein, avale le'meimar, asher hu oleo. If it would mean that the orif is getting filled, then it would mean, asher, it would say, umolo bote mitzroim, eso orev asher hu, not heim. Because the orev is usually referred to b'loshin yochid in a singular, would mean who. The fact that it says heim. So here too, we can understand that heim refers to the houses and the Egyptians which are upon the earth. And that earth is getting filled with orev. But the alkochach to chloimah the Rebbe said the pshute shel mikro. Shakavone b'asherim oleo ilabotim oilamitzrim sheloi rak yemole yo orev esabotim. That not only is the orev going to fill up the houses, elo yemale gam eso adomo asher abotim amitzrim oimdim oleo. In the simple reading of the pasuk, when it says umolu botim mitzrayim eso orev, means that the houses of Egypt are going to be filled with orev. Vegama adomo asher heim oleo, and the earth which the houses or the Egyptians are upon them would also be filled with the orev. V'hainu she'orev iye gam betoich adomo, inside the earth will be orev. But if that's what you're going to learn, and that's what it seems in pshuto shel mikro we have to learn, that it means the earth which the houses is dwelling upon them, but then it comes out that it's a new miracle. That animals are attacking, filling the houses, and somehow finding themselves under the houses, under the ground. But then it will be considered an unusual miracle. That you're going to have bad animals, beasts, inside the earth, which is hepechtivam. This is the opposite of the nature of an animal, to find an animal on the ground. Again, this would contradict what we have emphasized till now. There was no new miracles. The only miracle is the fact that they will mix together. But if you learn, like the simple verse indicates, that the Orev really didn't only attack the people in the houses, but they were somehow finding themselves on the ground. The earth, which the houses are upon them, or the Egyptians are upon them. So again, you're expanding the miracle, and this is not what the Torah tells us. So since Rashi wanted to understand what does the words Heimaleo mean. Therefore, Debod Badad Rashi, how can our Oroi find himself underground without making the miracle to look anything more unusual than the fact that they were mixed together? Velochein Muchra Rashi Lefareish, that what gets Rashi to explain, Shehoyu Shom Gam Nechoshim Vakrabim, that there was also snakes and scorpions. What's the chidush? Because Shebetivam, the nature of snakes and scorpions, Nimtzoyim Heim Beboiro Shebetoicha Adomo. They are available. Where do they find snakes, scorpions? They are actually in the pit, which is in this inside the ground. So when it says in the pasuk, "Umolu batim mitraim es ha'orev v'gamo adomo," so yes, they were all filled with the orev. The normal, regular animals were in the houses. The snake and the scorpions were on the ground. And this already minar also from chumish before that snake and scorpions are on the ground. It says in the pasuk earlier, regarding when Yosef was thrown into the pit, so it says, "Boy reik ein boy maim." There was an empty pit with no water. Pirush Rashi, "Maim ein boy." There was no water, but nechoshim v'akrabim yesh boy. There was filled with snakes and scorpions. Arei, shenechoshim v'akrabim nimtzoyim betivam, ba'boy roi shebetoicho oretz. This is natural for snakes and scorpions to be in the pit, which is inside, underground. That's not something against their nature. This is their nature. And therefore, the Oroiv, which was attacking them naturally, includes snakes and scorpions by the very fact that the Torah tells those words that the Adomo, the earth, was also filled with Oroiv. And if it means literally the Adomo, it means snakes and scorpions. But if Rashi comes to explain the words "Vegamo Adoma Sherei Moleo," so usually, as the Rebbe always learns, Rashi, when he explains a word in the Chumash, he puts it as an adder in his commentary, and then brings the explanation. But here he doesn't do it. Why? The Rebbe continues, "V'afal pichein ein Rashi matika tevois." Rashi does not copy the words from the pasuk "Vegamo Adoma Sherei Moleo." The earth which they were upon them, v'gamenu meramzlam bevegoimer. It doesn't even use like he usually does. At least he hints to the fact that vegoimer etc. So we will know that he is looking to explain that part of the pasuk too. Why doesn't he do it here? Ki ka'amur kan ein iker inyonoi shel Rashi lefareit mine achayos she'ev Yakodesh Boch v'makas oirov. Because Leo Rashi does not come to tell us which animals they were. Kim lehadgi shebo b'rbuvia. Rashi's whole idea is to explain what was the main thing of the Oroiv, that they came in a mixed manner, and this is the most important. V'rak derech agav mefareit she'oyu gam nechoshim v'akrabim. By the way, he explained there was also snakes and scorpions, but that's not the main thing. The main thing is what Oroiv is, and Oroiv means a mixture of animals. So this is clear that this is the Chiddush of Oroiv. But the Rebbe continues and Seif Ches and tells us of Namo Inyan Dorish Biur. But this very concept needs further explanation. Mai Achashivus Adover Shebo Berivuvia Ach Zeu Kol Achiddush B'Makozu. What is so great about the fact that they came mixed? Until you say that the whole Chiddush of this Mako is the fact that they came mixed. What's so special? I understand it's emphasizes something unusual, but why is it so important for that unusual occurrence, the mixture, to make it the biggest deal of Makas Oroiv? So here we go back to what we started in the Sikha before, in the beginning, the fact that Rashi brought the mushel from the Tzfardayim and how the Makas are related to the tactics of war. So let's see it inside. Rashi continues and says, "V'yesh tam bedovar be'agode bechol mako mako lo mozu ve'lo mozu." That in Agode, in the Medrash, there is really an explanation and a reason for every mako, why it was and why it came in that order. And by Rashi bringing that Medrash, is yuvin goydel achidu shebe oroiv. That is going to explain us what is the big chiddush regarding Arayv. What is so special, the fact that they came mixed. Because what does Rashi say? That Hashem came in the tactics of the way kings are leading wars. First they attacking the water stream, which is the dam. And then what they do, they are sounding and blowing shofars leyorom ulevalom to scare them and to confuse them. Vechein atzfardeim, and so it was what atzfardeim mekarkerim veoimim. The frogs were cracking and making noise. Vechulu kede isev menestatanchume. Nimtza. What comes out from this medrash? What I've been learning from this medrash is she'echod mi'iker tachsise milchomo, one of the main tactics of war. This is number two. Ulasis peulois leyorom ulevalom. The attackers are looking for ways to get the inhabitants of the inside city to get scared and confused. They especially do activities leyorom. They sound shofars, they create noise, and that is going to bring a fear, a confusion on the people which are being besieged. So from there, Rashi takes that al derech zo b'makas orif. The importance of that fear, of the confusion, is really what is happening now in makas orif. The tam she'evies achayo is b'ilbuvia. You know why they came mixed? Ukedei leyorom ulevalom is in order to scare them and confuse them. Ki kasher achayos kol min le'atzmoi, then eina bahol egdele kol kach. When each type of animal comes on its own, if it would be only lions or only bears, then the confusion is not as great and as scary than when they all come together, but every type and every different animal. Aval kasher boim harbe chayos mi harbe minim, many animals from all different types ubilbuvia and mixed. As a behole ve'ire gdeilus b'yoyso, then the fear and the confusion is much, much greater. And we learn from this medrash that a part of the attack is also causing fear and confusion. And this is what the medrash tells us regarding the tzfardeya. And Rashi understands that ba'oroiv is this is really was a part of that ness of the miracle when they came mixed, because it wasn't only that they injured the Egyptians, but it created tremendous confusion and fear from seeing all different types of animals joining together in an attack. And this is going to explain us now Rashi. He asked before, why does Rashi bring, and Rashi explains, he brings the Medrash, and he ends by Tzfardeya, I mean, not even continuing what the Medrash says about Orev. But now it's understood. Let's see it inside. Umikivin shekavonose levair goydel achashivu shelirbuvia. Since Rashi's intention is to explain mostly what the mix does and how it is important to the mako that there was something which created fear and confusion. Lochein mevi Rashi tam zeshala mako iskan. That's why only here, when it comes to Oroiv, Rashi brings that medrash which explains the reason for the makas. Ubehemshech lemashekosav lifnei ze beoiso adibur. Continuing what you wrote earlier, that what happened over here, that there was animals who were incited against the Egyptians. I knew, and he brings only umevi raktam shel beis makas arishoynes. And he only brings the two makas. And he doesn't bring, but the medrash continues more with the other reasons, with the other makas. Because really Rashi is intending to understand what happened in makas orev. And the way he understands what happened in makas orev, the fear which was brought to the mixed, is being explained with the medrash which talks about Tzfardeya. ובמילא מובן גם כן לומר מפרש רשי הנים של רגל מכה שפדיה. Why does Rashi explain that only the nimshel? He doesn't explain by dam, he brings the mashal about attacking the water channels, but he doesn't explain the connection to dam. We figured out ourselves. But Vatsvadeya, he brings the noise of the shofars, and he explains also that this is what Tzvadeya do. Why does he do it, Rashi? Why does he bring the nimshel, the explanation, dafka Vatsvadeya? Kirak al de nimshel de makozu. Yoidi, we understand, she'amako is oyo inyan, she'le yorom ulevalom. The nimshul, which tells you that that's what the tzfadeya did, the tzfadeya created noise and confusion, we understand over here how the oroiv was also serving the same purpose to bring fear and dread. ואף על פי כן, מוכרח רשי להקדים שטעם ונבע באגודה. Even though, אף שגם בפשוט השם מיקרום ישבוקם לסבור הזו, בכנל סעיף ג' like we said before, that even in simple understanding of the Pasuk, we can also use the Midrashic reasonings about attacking the water source and bringing the noise of the Tzfardim, etc. So why does Rashi say that it's on a Midrash which explains it to us? Because like we said earlier, in the simple reading of the Pasuk, we have reasons why those plagues took place. The first two plagues, blood and frogs, was lehalkos yirosom, to also smash their god, their idol, which was the Nile River. The makos kinim was following that, was lares lachartumim, to show the witchcrafters of Mitzrayim, she'etz ba'alikim he, that only God can do it. Kanalak explained earlier. Only when it comes to Oroiv is when you need that extra explanation which is mentioned in the Medrash regarding all the Makis. We don't need it for the first three Makis. And for the first three Makis, as far as we are concerned, that's a Medrash, like any other Medrash. We have other good reasons why that Makis took place in the way it took place. But now that you're coming to quote that Medrash because it's necessary to explain what is so unique about Oroiv, how it was important to create a mix which will bring about fear on the Egyptians. Lochein magdim Rashi, shetam zehu ba'agodah. Really, it's a god, it's a medrash. In Pshutish and Mikro, we had good reasons till now. So why am I bringing it to you? Because I will be a god azu, yuvan atam, lomo yivion beirbuvia, because that medrash is going to explain you why Oroif came, animals came mixed together, like we said before, to create fear, as that medrash tells us regarding Tzvadeya, that fear is a part of the tactics of war. And he brings that kei arayin tamze soyser lepshutish and mikro. This medrashic explanations about dam and sfardeya attacking the water, creating noise, is not really a contradiction to the simple understanding of the reasons which we understand that their god should be beaten and they should realize that it's only Hashem who made the water plague. The fact that you bring the medrash now doesn't contradict it. L'shein emuchach. It's not needed, it's not necessary. Those earlier reasons that we said about dam and sfardeya and kinim is clearly mentioned and understood from where and how they were written. But this now is really not clearly in the pasuk itself. It's from the medrash we understand the importance of creating a mix in how this will bring a great fear on the Mitzri. It says in order 32, al pi de muvon lashon Rashi, Rashi says v'yesh tam badovor be'agode, v'chol mako mako lomo zu v'lomo zu. V'lechu re'a v'lemeima v'yesh tam be'agode. Why did it say badovor regarding the matter? Ki badovor ha'kavone l'mashakotho lifnei ze, b'ilbuvye. The word Badover is that what Rashi said before, that the Oroif came a mix of animals. So in that Dover, we have now an understanding from the Medrash. In that Medrash, which is Ba'oroif, We have an explanation from Be'agoda, but the way the message was written, Bechol Mako. But the Rebbe said, Bedoicha Ktas, because really, it is not fitting with the simple reading of those words in Rashi. V'yeshtam bedover, as if the dover refers dafke to oroiv, is a doichak, but bedoichak for sure, we can fit it into the words that the bedover refers to oroiv, that in that matter, in the way oroiv came, we will find a reason in the agod. And the Rebbe finishes up seif tes. It's still not clear completely. It's not a full question, but there's still something missing, which therefore the explanation for that, which is going to bring in a moment the difficulty, is only hinted by Rashi by bringing the Tanchuma. As you remember before, Rashi starts the Medrash, and he ends up kede ise be medrash rab tanchuma. And the question was, why is he bringing medrash rab tanchuma? Why doesn't he include it in one line that says in the medrash? So the Rebbe said, because there is really something else bothering Rashi. What is it? Vehu. Ein emes, this is true. Ki mashe bo berbuv ye'inin godlu hamebal belom. The fact that they came mixed is something important, and it confuses them, etc., and it brings fear. After all, the question is, why is only this fact that they came mixed, is what the Pasuk says, v'yishlachti bochem eso oroiv, the mixture. Ke'ilu, she'etzem adovor shebo chayu ezroiv v'yishchisu, b'men nechshavu be'orkoi. As if to say, the very fact that animals came and they attacked, is almost unconsidered to the very fact that they came mixed. Yes, the fact that they came mixed brought a tremendous fear and confusion by the Egyptian, but it's still questionable. Is that the only thing about the Oroiv? It's almost like we don't consider the fact that there was bad animals which attacked. Rashi. Rashi hints by writing the words, what does it say, Medrash Rab Tanchuma? Shom, in that Medrash Rab Tanchuma, Be'emshlech le'inyin anal, Mesuper, the Medrash says, Asher kirkuron oyo koshelohem mi'ashchososom. But it's Fardeya, he says, that the noise that frogs made, the noise which brought this confusion and the fear from the calling of the frogs, everywhere, inside their stomachs, inside their houses, everywhere they moved, they couldn't understand, they couldn't talk to each other, was worse than the destruction that the frogs accomplished. This is where the Tanchuma ends. So with these words, really, moving gamen egale oroiv, she says, iker godl ba'amake admoid, that this is really their biggest thing in the oroiv, was really even more than the fact that they attacked, was the confusion and the fear of the how they came with that mix they came. In other words, just like Batsfardeya, it wasn't what the Tzfardeya consumed and destroyed, but rather it was the noise. Here too, it is that fear and confusion created by that mixed. And this is hinted by Rashi saying, because these words, that the noise was worse than their destruction, is only found in Medrash Tanchuma. Mitam ze gam Yosef Rashi v'chulu, after lefi anal, based on the way I mentioned before, ein ze negea kan mashekosh v'shom acharko bekesher l'shar ha-makos. We really only have to understand what the frogs did, in that the confusion and noise is a tactic of war. So why do Rashi say v'chulu? You're not interested in looking and understanding the rest of the plagues based on that medrash. Because ki ein kavadosi bevechulu latam shara makoishon bemedrash. It doesn't mean the vechulu that you're going to find there more reasons regarding the order and how and why the plagues came. No. Because this we don't need here ba'oriv. The main thing is what Rashi tells you, looking in medrash tanchume vechulu, is lemashekosav etc. refers to those words that he mentioned earlier. Kirkuron hoyo kosher lohem me'ash chososom. That their calling and their crouching was worse than their destruction. The noise was worse than what they actually caused with their destruction. This is the words I want you to see, Medrash Rav Tanchuma, which will explain you why Ba'oroiv is the Ilbuvia, the mix, that which was worse than anything else. Seif Yud, the Rebbe is going now to explain another special thing that we find necessarily Ba'oroiv and we don't find in the previous Makkos till now. Al Pia Omu Le'il, שעיקר הטעם לגימול מקס הראשונות בפשוטה של מיקרו, אינו איתם המדרש. Like we said till now, that if three מקס דם ספרדי הכינים, it's not what the מדרש says that this is war tactics, כי הם להלכו יש אירוסם, the first מקו and the second מקו, עם פשוטה של מיקרו, the Rebbe explained earlier, was mainly to show and to give a mako to smash their daddy, their god, the river, the Nile River, ולארוס לחרטומים, and to show to the sorcerers of Mitzrayim, אצבא אלוהיקים היא, that when it came to Makas Kinim, and they realized that this is not, as they said, this is אצבא אלוהיקים, this is the finger of God, this mako, the sorcerers said, is not a plague which resulted of witchcraft. So clearly, it has their purpose. And it wasn't just, like the Medrash says, to attack the water and to create noise. But the Pshuto Shel Mikra in the simple reading, those are the reasons. And this was explained earlier in the beginning of the Sicha. When we have learned that in Seif Gimel. Based on that, we're going to understand Yuvan Oidinyan. Something else regarding Oroiv. Pemakas Oroiv, Kosov V'Charkoch. It says regarding Makas Oroiv, V'Yiflesi B'Yoimahu Es Eretz Goyshen Asher Ami Oimed Elel. Moshe tells it's going to be the plague of the oroiv of the mixed of animals. So it says in Pasuk Yudches that on that day I shall distinguish, separate the land of Goshen upon which my people stand, lebilti eyoy shom oroiv, that there shall not be that mixture of the wild beasts, lemanteida. So this is what Hashem tells Moshe, that in Goshen, with the Yidden shall Tzebnei Yisrael, loy oiso makas oriv, that by the Jewish people, when they settled, there was no plague of oriv. V'koshe, lomo loy kosuv begimul makas harishoinoi, shloy oyu et Tzebnei Yisrael. Why is it not written in the first three makos that they also did not occur in Goshen or whatever the Jewish people lived? Ve'im u'dovar ha'poshu to move in. If it's so understood that a Jew was not affected by those plagues, madua mefashay ha'kosu v'makasayorov, so when it comes to Oroiv, you specifically tell us that, no, in Goshen it's not going to happen. If it didn't happen till now, it's for sure not going to happen now either. What is so special about Oroiv that here we need a special so-called information that Hashem says that the Bnei Yisrael are not going to be impacted by the Oriv. So in general, whether or not the Makos did impact Jews or not, the Rebbe brings the two opinions and many opinions which is discussed in the Mefarshei HaTorah. But let's see us inside. Beinyan ze yesh lom kamo deyes. There is a few opinions whether or not the Makos impacted Jews. Or Evan Ezra, the Evan Ezra in two places in this parasha, Koisev, Ira, it's clear, ulefidaiti ki makas adam v'asfadeya v'akinim oiso koileles amitzrim ve'o ivrim chulu. He says that the first three plagues was not Mitzrim only. Matter of fact, he says that even Jews were also affected by the Makkah, were also infected by that plague. He only says that Ve'elu Asholosh Me'at Iziku, that these three brought a small damage, and therefore we were also, the Bnei Yisrael were also affected by it. But he says, Rak Makkah so Oroiv, she'oi so kosho, when it came Oroiv, Oroiv was a difficult plague, and it was killing from the people who apparently were hit by those, bitten by those animals. Vir is where Hashem ifrish bein ha-Mitzrim ubein Yisrael. So the Ibn Ezra, he actually quotes that there are those who say that it wasn't like this. For example, by Dam, that there was some, the water by the Egyptians was red. When the Jew took the same cup in his hand that was white, the Ibn Ezra says clearly, in his opinion, that's not the case. The Jews suffered through from the Makkos. But either way, he says, the people were not so majorly affected by the three Makkos, but Oroiv, Diriz Vur Hashem says, that's it. This time, Egyptians only. This is the one opinion, the Ebenezer's opinion. Omnom Radbaz, the Chuvosoi, the Radbaz wrote a long response on this issue with the Makkos, whether the Jews were or not affected, and he writes, that Umash, Ekosa, Varav, Avrom, Ben Ezra, Ki Makkos Adam, Vatzvadim, Vakinim, Moithol, and Mitzrayim, that these plagues, first three was only for Egypt. I'm sorry, Oysol and Mitzrayim, Hule Yisrael, was for Egypt and for Israel. Says the Radbaz, Osur le'amin darvo ze. We shouldn't believe such a thing. I guess he also assumes to say that we shouldn't believe that Ibn Ezra said such a thing. Not only that we shouldn't believe in it, the Ibn Ezra was a very acceptable Mefarish. I guess he also means that we shouldn't believe that Ibn Ezra wrote it. Kolshken sha'ksuvim moirim lehefech. The psukim, the very literal psukim, show opposite. They show that only Mitzrayim was suffering. No one knows how. But the first Makkah Badam, what does it say? Belo yochlu Mitzrayim lishtos min ha'yor, that Egypt was not able to drink from the river. And therefore, vayachperu Mitzrayim svivos ha'yor. Egypt was digging around the river to find water. Mashma, aval Yisrael lo yoyitzrichim leze, that the Am Yisrael, the Jews, did not need to dig for water. Ki hoyu shoysim mi mei mei ha'yor. A Jew picked up a cup of water from the same river, and for him it was water. It wasn't blood. It says in the Pasik, Mitzrayim. Same thing, he continues the Radbaz, Ubetzfardim Ksiv, in the second plague, Befrag, it says, Ubecho Ubeamecho, you Paroi and your people. And then it continues, Vesorua Tzfardim, the Tzfardim are going to be removed, Mimcho, Umibotecho, U Meavodecho, Umiamcho, from you, from your people, and from your nation, which again indicates Mashma Sheloya Yube Yisrael, that Bnei Yisrael were not affected. And same he continues, Vechena Kinim, Be'il Moitzosu Mena Mefuresh, that by Kinim, the fact that it doesn't specify that the Jews were also attacked, so we're also going to learn that it was only affecting the Egyptians. Beloyodati Mamako Iso, Beloyodati, he continues, Imamako Iso Gamle Yisrael, Maraye Yeshbo Le Paroi Sheishlach Es Yisrael. He says even more. If really the Jews were also affected, so then why would it prove Paroi that he has to send them? So really, the psukim that the Ibn Ezra brings, so this psukim can mean that they were including everyone, but the Mitzrayim were mainly affected by it, as the Rebbe is going to bring soon. But this is a main discussion which here is brought in the name of the Ibn Ezra versus the Radbaz. Rambam bePirush HaMishnayos on Pirkei Avos, when it says Asara Nisim Nasa LaAviseinu, the Rambam brings, he brings it b'shem Chachamim, the Meiri brings it Omru b'Talmud, the what? Shemakas Dam v'Tzfardeya lo yoyu b'Yisrael klal. The Dam v'Tzfardeya did not affect the Jews at all. This is like the Ibn Ezra writes, Mash Enkin Makas Kinim oiso gamboem. When it came to the third Makkah, the Rambam brings that the Jews did have kinim, but lo yoyu metzarim oisom. The kinim was everywhere, but they weren't painful, they weren't distressed by it. Meaning the Jews were not distressed by it. So we have different opinions. So the Rebbe says, Umikivin, she'ein Rashi metaritz. Afilu beremez, akushi elom oloi nichta v'ifleisi v'geibe begil maksa rishoynos. We had a question, which is a very important question. Bottom line is, when it comes to the fourth plague, Oroiv, Diris Buditere clearly writes, I'm going to separate Goshen from the rest of Mitzrayim regarding that plague. So why doesn't it say in regarding the first three plagues? That question, Rashi doesn't even answer. And therefore, Muchach, Asher bepshuta shel mikro, hoyu ha-makis ha-rishoynos gam b'Yisrael. We actually learn from here that when it came to those makos, the Jewish people did and were affected by those plagues. V'chein nireh gam im asher kosu v'tei akinom ba'odom uba be'emo. Odom stam. That the kinem was by Odom. Odom means every people. V'gam ein loimar shemakas kinim lo yoyu metzarim oisom. Like the Rambam brought, that we added, but we weren't stressed by it, ki minalon kein b'pshuta shel mikro. In pshuta shel mikro, in the simple understanding from the Pasik, we don't have any reason to explain that the makas were not impacting us. So clearly, since it's not mentioned anything in the Pasik, and the fact that only the Mitzrim are mentioned is again not a proof to say that only them, as the Rebbe continues, Benegal le Kushya Saradbaz, Lomo Madgish Akosuv Mitzrayim b'makas dam v'tzfardeya. That's not a big question, because moving bepashtus, Shari Zehu o Iker b'avo asa makos. The fact that it doesn't say that the Jews were, it says Mitzrayim, is not a big question, because they were the main in purpose of the Makos. Even though, practically speaking, that we were hit too. Actually, the Rebbe Ezra clearly says it, and the Rebbe brings it before in Order 36. The Rebbe Ezra brings, in the name of Yefes, that Yefes said that since the Pasuk writes, Becho Be'amecho, means only him, Paroi, and his people. And the Rebbe Ezra says, no. Amecho means all you people, and doesn't have to mention the Jewish people. Everybody was affected by it. And Pshuta Shel Mikro means that we all dealt with the makos. But then comes the question, which is taka an important question. In the Radbaz asked this question. Avol b'nei kusha se'achroino. The last question of the Radbaz, kosher be'emes lichure. And he quotes the lashon of the Radbaz, that which is, im ha-mako iso gam le-Yisrael, ma raye yesh bo le-paro she-yishlach es Yisrael. If the plagues were also for the Jews, so how would Paro learn that he has to send them? Everybody is eaten, is beaten. His people, their people. What message does it give to Paro? Vegamin also lomo be'emes oyu amakos gam b'Yisrael. Why should the Jewish people also get plagued? Why do they deserve to get plagues? So the question is, number one, why ba'oroiv the separation took place? And the question number two is, why taket did be affected by the makos in Pshuto Shel Mikro until oroiv? Aval al pi anal muvin, based on the way we explained earlier the reason for the first three makos, we will answer that question too. What happened until Orev? Mikivin, sh'estei ha-makos harishonos, regarding the first two plagues, pirush Rashi. Shehev Yakodish Borchu bishvil lehalko yisirosom. Rashi clearly says that it was in order to punish their God. Right? Rashi says it regarding Dam, that there is no rain in Mitzrayim. So the Mitzrayim used to worship the Nilus, and therefore they considered that they are God. So therefore the Nilus was plagued first, and after that the Egyptians themselves. So the idea of Dam was to plague that which Mitzrayim considered a God, and they used to worship. This is the Dam. Are moving. When Paro is going to see that his idol is the one who gets plagued, that's going to fulfill the purpose of the plague, which is for Paro to know there is a God. So now he's going to know there is a God. Ve'im gam le'Yisrael izbelu mizeh, lo yituktan al yedei zeh al koeh ba'avodah zarah sheloi. The fact that the Jewish people would also get affected by that mako, it's still not going to diminish the fact that his idol, his God, is getting bitten by turning into blood. Ve'ad rabbe, mitam ze'atzmoi oyom muchach shetiyeno beiz makos elu gam b'mayim shel bnei Yisrael. For the very fact that the interest in the agenda here was to hit Paro's God, it was necessary that all water of the Nilus should have been affected by it, even that what the Jews are benefiting from. Why? Their daddy, their God, gets smashed. Every place would they have their idol, there is also tzricho liyos hamakoshom, had to be plagued. Because the imloikein, if there's going to be a spot which it doesn't get hit, Yachshev Paroi, Paroi will then consider Shechelek Zeh Mi'avoyed Ezor Shaloi, at least that part, Animtza Begoyshen V'kayotze B'zeh, Godel Yosech Chas V'Sholem Mi'akodesh Baruch Hu. Paroi can come and make a consideration. Look, there is a part of Nilus which wasn't affected. It happens to be in the area where the Jews lived, but it means there's one area which my God, Chas V'Sholem, God forbid, is stronger. And obviously this applies to the Tzfardeya also, as we learned in the beginning of the Sikha, the Tzfardeya was really also to impact the Ye'or, the river. It was considered beating the Ye'or. Therefore it was Aaron who did it, not Moshe. The whole idea of the Tzfardeya was to cancel the strength of the Nilus, the strength of Mitzrayim, the God of Mitzrayim, which was really explained in Lent in a Sikha of the Rebbe in Shabbos Parshas Boy, Tav Shin Mem Dalet, that the whole idea of Dam and Tzfardeya was to break that force of Mitzrayim. And therefore, it needed to be everywhere. And the prize that the Jews were also affected, but to show that the Rebbe still dominates the Nilus, and the Nilus has no power. So the fact that the Jews were hit by the Dam and Tzfardeya doesn't lessen the warning against Paroi. He sees that his Avodah Zarah, which is the most important thing, gets hit by God. And that's what was accomplished. And the Rebbe explains also, the water around the he doesn't explain it here, but the Rasich and Chedek Lamed Aleph, the Rebbe explains actually that the water around the Nilus was not affected. And according to Pshutish and Mikro, they were able to drink water from there because the main purpose was to have an impact on their God, and on their God only. Alder Rebbe Makas Kinim. When it came to Kinim, the third Mak is the same thing. That what? Mekivu shakavone oiso shal yodo. Yigua chartumim she'etzba leikimi. The main purpose of the kinim was that they should see that God is in control. And God did it. And the hoyo akore, hoyo echech, I'm sorry, she tiye bilte mugbeles bekol eres Mitzrayim. That's why also it was necessary that it should be everywhere, even where the Jews lived. Ki belav ocher yomokim leimar she nasit aladei mugbolim. If it wouldn't impact the Jews, so then the sorcerers would say that this makeh was not done chad v'shalom by God. It was done by limited people, Moshe and Aaron, considering them al ibnei Odom, Moshe v'Aaron shechartum im'eim, they are themselves a sorcerers, k'moshe omru b'beiz makeh sarishonos, like the Egyptians said in the first two makehs. V'af shechartum im'itzrayim lo yuchlu lehaloi sakinim, and even though that their sorcerers were not able to bring up kinim, so they would say, "Gam Moshe v'Aaron lo yuchlo la'alo isa." Moshe v'Aaron also didn't have the ability to bring them up. Where did you bring it up? Elo al shetach v'anoshim mesuyomim, only on a specific area, specific people. Which in the fact that you brought it up in a specific area, El Shebaze, Gdoilim Yoisa Michatub and Mitzrayim. In that part, you are stronger than me. You can do more than me. But more than that, you can't do. And that will take away the impact of Kinim, which is ultimately to make sure that they come and make a declaration that this is Etzba Elikim. The Rebishter is the one involved here. This is no limitations. And that will enforce them to say that Moshe and Aaron are not just greater to them, but it's the Rebishter who does it. And for that reason, L'chei noisa mukhach asliyat b'chol mokoim gam b'bnei Yisrael. And therefore, it had to be everywhere. So that's why we understand that in order to bring home the purpose of Dam and Sfardeya and Kinim, it had to be everywhere, and the price the Jews were also infected or impacted by it. Because the whole idea was to teach a lesson to Paroi and to the Chartume Paroi, to the sorcerers of Paroi. And that was accomplished that everywhere gets impacted by that plague. Makos Orev was clearly only to punish them. There was no need for proving any of the above. Therefore, Nema Veiflesi. That was explained by Orev. Hashem says, this Mako, only Egyptians will get impacted, and the Jews will be clear, they will not be affected by it. Seif Yudalef. Bepnimis HaInyonim. The Rebbe now explained, according to Chassidus, why was it necessary by Oroiv, again, to make this distinction between Mitzrayim and the rest of and the Bnei Yisrael. Primis and Yonim Yeshlemer Atam Ashoyev Iflesi Dafke B'Makos Oroiv. Why Dafke by Oroiv was the separation between Goshen and the rest? So it's as follows: Begimul Makos Arishoyno is Loyoyo Minatzorech LeHafrish BeBnei Yisrael VaMitzrim. In the first three Makos, it was not necessary to separate between Bnei Yisrael and the Egyptians. Ki Afim Gam Hoyu Amakos BeYisrael. Even if we were affected by it. It wouldn't have occurred on anyone's mind. Never gave us a thought that we can, chas v'sholem, God forbid, join and mix with the Egyptians. Going back to what we said before, that the main message of Oroiv and the main chidush, the novelty of Oroiv, is the mix of all animals. So the fact that all animals are mixed, somehow to see such a mixture, hoyos mokel lemachshev eschutz shekeilu esir HaKadosh Baruch Hu es kol hamechitzes, as if God had removed all barriers. Just as all animals are suddenly joining in one force between the snake and the scorpion, there is no separation. The animals and the snakes, no one is separated anymore. This is a chiddush. God somehow removed barriers. So a Yid in Mitzrayim, in the state of Mitzrayim, may think that there's no more barriers altogether. Ubimele nifratz gam hageder ben Yisrael lahamim lahavdil. That Chas v'Shalom broke and removed the fence between Am Yisrael and the rest of the nation. As chofetz HaKadosh Baruch Hu leharis, because God the desire to show shamechitza kayemes gam b'shozu, even in a time when seemingly there is no barrier between animals, but there is still one barrier which is unremovable. And this is the separation between Israel and the rest of the nations. Elohein, he also shem shodet in the plague itself, that even all animals are going loose and wild and open and no mixture, and the whole idea is they are mixed together, no separation, but they are mixed together. So comes to Oroi, v'ifleisi b'yoyim ha'u es ami asher emid olo. I'm going to distinguish them and separate them. V'sam tibdus b'in ami b'in amecho. I'm going to create a distinction between my people, the people of Israel, and the people of Paroi. V'yroim zeh uvenes b'pashtus. What's the lesson? Davke b'sho in a time asher libur v'yeh b'oilam. That there is such confusion and mixture in the world in general. The defenses of the world are broken and shattered in a way as never before. It's extremely important to strengthen the distinction between the Jewish people and the rest of the world. If then, before the Torah was given, which means before we were chosen, because the choice of Am Yisrael, as he brings from the Shulchan Aruch, really happened when the Torah was given. So here we are holding about the plagues, which is before even the Torah was given. And Bizman Sheoyo Oroiv, there was a plague which creates and represents a mix. And it was a concern that maybe there is no more barriers. If in that particular time, Moshe HaKadosh Baruch Hu Nes Meyuchad, Hashem made a special miracle, Losum B'duz Bein Ami U'Bein Amecho, to create a separation between Am Yisrael and the rest. Halachas Kam V'Kam V'Zmaneinu Zeh, in our time, the importance of creating that separation. And regarding the fact that it was a special miracle to create the separation, the Rebbe brings in Ore 45, Kamavua Bekam Forsha Chumash, Rabbi Nebuchadnezzar, and others, Allah possibly Flacy, that they write, Chal Piteva. Naturally speaking, Keshechayo is Rois, Oilcho is Chofshi, when beasts, when animals get loose, Ein Matzo Lerucho, no one can stop it. They go everywhere. We made it so that Chlio is Nes Meyuchad, it does require a special miracle, Lehagbilam, to limitate them, miloleches leretz goyshen, to get into goyshen, because when they get loose, they go everywhere. So there was a special miracle, and the special miracle was specially done, not maybe for the Oroiv itself, but rather to give the lesson for the Bnei Yisrael who are watching that mix of Oroiv. Ve'inyan da'avdolu b'du zu oye b'negea lekol echad v'echad b'nei Yisrael was regarding every single zoo. Even those Jews which never wanted to leave Mitzrayim, they also were provided with that lesson of separation. Is an additional lesson from this story. Applies to each and every man and woman which are only called Jews, even if they consider themselves maybe not people who would want to leave Egypt, they still also are impacted by the lesson of the separation which Hashem created miraculously to separate Egypt from the rest of the world when it came to Oroiv, that Jews don't mix. And Abnei Yisrael will strengthen that mechitza, that separation. Cause that we wouldn't have any barriers or anything that separates, God forbid, between Hashem and the Jewish people. Bekolechot ve'achas miYisrael, and each and every Jew, Yoshu betshuva shleimo, u'miyad ein igolin, begeula amitit v'ashleimo, al-edei Moshiach tzedkenu. So clearly, the Rebbe in the Sicha brought a tremendous insight into the old story of the Oroiv. And now when you read the Pasuk of Oroiv, it has a twist to it. If I'm going to read it now again, back to the beginning of the Sicha, verse 17, so it's going to be read as follows. Ki im eincho meshaleach es ami, for if you do not send out my people, hineni mashliach becho, I will incite becho into you, against you, ubeavodecho, against your servants, ubeamecho, and against your people, eso oroiv. I will incite a oroiv. What's oroiv? A mix of wild beasts, snakes, and scorpions. Ubebotecho es oroiv, which means, as the Rebbe learned in Rashi, I will incite them, those animals, to be especially vicious. Not the usual incitement which an animal has naturally, but like Lashon Meshase, especially vicious. And they will harm you and bring destruction throughout your land. And I will bring them to Egypt from the surrounding areas. And they will, this is the whole idea of this Oroiv, that they will come miraculously in a very unexpected mixture. And this mixture will be more terrifying if they were to have come naturally, species by species. But here they will come grouped, all different species together. And the houses of Mitzrayim, umolu bote Mitzrayim es oroiv, the houses of the Egyptians will be filled with that mix of the animals, of the wild beast, vegama domo asher emoleo, and as well the ground upon which they stand, the houses stand, or the Egyptians stand, will be also filled with the snakes and the scorpions which will join the oroiv. In Beiflesi Bayoim Ahu Es Eretz Goyshen, Pasuk Yud Ches says, on that day, unlike with the first three plagues, which the Jews were also impacted, on this plague I will set apart Goyshen, Asher Am Yoim Edoleo, where my people dwells, Lebilti Eyoi Shom Oroiv, so that there will not be a mixed Oroiv there in Goyshen, Leman Teida Ke Ani Hashem Bekevoret, you will realize that I am God, even in the earth of Goyshen, Vesamti Bdus, and the rest of the story of the Oroiv.